Let's continue. Consider the words the girl uses to continue her story. But to get to the end of the tale, which has none, of my misfortunes, I want to pass over in silence the diligences that Fernando deployed to declare his desire to me. The girl uses virtually the same theugma that Cardenio used to resume his story in chapter 27. Cervantes is signaling to us that these two stories have something in common. So Fernando devoted himself to seducing her. He bribed the people of her household and even other members of her family, hired musicians to sing outside her window at night, and above all, he sent letters, billetes, that were infinite, full of lovers' persuasions and offerings, with more promises and oaths than written characters. Here, the peasant admits that although her modesty compelled her to resist Fernando's advances, she was tempted. She even gives a disquisition on the psychology of women. I felt a certain pleasure at seeing myself so desired and so esteemed by such a distinguished gentleman, principal caballero. Nor did it weigh on me to see myself praised in his letters, for as homely as we women might be, it seems to me that we are always made happy by hearing ourselves called beautiful. The attitude of the peasant girl's parents during all of this is interesting. They said that the inequality between their daughter and the Duke's son was reason enough to believe that his attentions were false. And to put an end to the matter, they offered to marry her to another of the principal men in the area. And so the peasant girl fortified her integrity. And now she tells us something about male psychology as well. All of my precautions, which he must have taken as disdain, must have stoked all the more his lustful appetite, for that is the name I will give to the desire he showed me. When Don Fernando realizes that the girl's parents are about to marry their daughter, somehow, can you guess how? He manages to penetrate the peasant's house. By the way, we are now reading a section of Don Quixote that was considered so erotic in its day that it was finally censored by the Portuguese Inquisition in 1624. It so happened that one night I was alone in my room with the sole company of a maid that served me, having tightly locked the doors, wary that by some oversight my virtue should be put at risk. And without knowing or imagining how, in spite of all these precautions and preventions, and amidst the solitude of that silence and confinement, I found him standing before me. The sight of him so troubled me that I lost that of my own eyes, and I was unable to speak. She then recounts how she lacked strength to defend herself, and so Fernando took her in his arms and declared his love. Note another of those odd commercial touches that Cervantes always inserts in such moments. The traitor's tears gave credit to his words, and his sighs certified his intention. The peasant girl regained her lost spirits and responded, "If, as I am, sir, in your clutches, I were in those of a fierce lion, and to be free of them could be assured me by my doing or saying something which would perjure my modesty, then I could no more do or say that thing than it is possible for what time has wrought to have never occurred." The brave girl tells Fernando how things are. Her moral reprimand is powerful and fundamental to the rest of the novel. "Your vassal I am, but not your slave. The nobility of your blood neither has, nor should have, the right to dishonor and belittle the humbleness of mine." She concludes her reply by telling the Duke's son that nothing will happen so long as they are not legally married. Fernando's reaction: "Beautiful Dorothea, see here how I give you my hand to be your husband," and he indicates an image of the Virgin Mary as the witness to their wedding. By the way, many of Cervantes' contemporaries would have considered this a legitimate way to marry secretly, but the Council of Trent banned the practice. We should also note that Cardenio interrupts here, saying that he has heard of a woman named Dorothea. If we remember, Cardenio already knows how this story ends.